all youthful and with a lot of vim and vinegar, and just had fun in making cartoons. We had a lot of fun, and it showed in the cartoons.
We would use little gags, like on Porky's Duck Hunt. We had breakthrough gags where Porky brings out a script, you know, and he looks it up and he says to the duck, he says, "That's not in the script."
Hey, that wasn't in the script.
Pepe Le Pew, for instance, is a character I would love to be. I'd like to be the kind of a person who girls adore, you know, and can't ever see anything wrong with him. He doesn't know that he smells badly, you know, being a skunk.
Quelle est-ce? Ah, les belles femmes skunk fait-elle. It is love at first sight, is it not? No? Mm-hmm.
Daffy Duck, they wanted him to say terrible or real bad about somebody. And I said, why don't you get a word where he can have an S's in it so that he can spray when he speaks? So someone, I don't know who it was, said, how about despicable? I said, great. You're despicable.
I'm John Canemaker for Camera 3. And those four gentlemen, Bob Clampett, Friz Freleng, Mel Blanc, and Chuck Jones, they were some of the guys who turned out the funniest animated cartoons ever made, the Looney Tunes and Merry Melodies of the Warner Brothers studio. As an animator and as a writer in animation history, and just as a fan, it was a thrill for me to meet and to listen to these artists explain how they developed such great characters as Bugs Bunny and Daffy Duck, and how they developed their own brash, fast-paced, freewheeling style that added so much to the emotional and entertainment palette of American animation. This style was developed at Termite Terrace, which was the affectionate nickname that the artist gave to a dilapidated old cartoon building on the Warner's lot in downtown Hollywood. Warner's began making animated cartoons in 1929 with a very small staff, and they turned out 13 in 1 year. But during the peak years, the most successful years of the late 30s, the 1940s and 50s, the gang from Termite Terrace had grown to a group of 200, and they were turning out around 42 cartoons a year, the heaviest schedule of any of the cartoon studios. Warner's officially closed its cartoon studio in 1964. So most of the films you'll be seeing on this program, and indeed most of the Merry Melodies and Looney Tunes that are still cracking you up every morning on television, are films that were made between 12 or 35 or even 40 years ago. But amazingly, they are still as fresh and as vital, and most importantly, as funny as if they were being made today. Our story begins with a man whose very name is synonymous with the animated cartoon, Walt Disney. In 1923, Walt Disney set up his Hollywood studio, and within 2 years he was expanding his staff with young cartoonists whom he had previously known and worked with in Kansas City. Among them were Hugh Harmon, Rudolph Ising, Friz Freleng, and a very skilled draftsman by the unusual name of Ub Iwerks. It was Iwerks who became the top animator of his generation, is credited with the design of Mickey Mouse, and was the man responsible for the establishment of the Disney style. This style is based on skilled draftsmanship and caricatured reality, and was absorbed by everyone who ever worked at Disney's. Bosco the Talking Kid was a character in a short sales film produced in 1929 by Harmon and Ising, who were now independent producers. Bosco was seen by a businessman, Leon Schlesinger, who was able to get a Bosco series released through Warner Brothers, and the series was called Looney Tunes. A second series, Merry Melodies, soon followed, which also imitated in title, and more so in content, Disney's popular musical series, The Silly Symphonies. In 1932, Harmon and Ising left for MGM, taking Bosco with him, and that left Schlesinger in kind of a mess because he had no popular characters, and he was starting to do stories that were rehashes of stories that had been done many times before. Robert Clampett had arrived at the studio in 1931 while Harmon and Ising were still there. He worked briefly as an animator before becoming a director while still in his mid-20s. Clampett's trademarks were an extreme elasticity and distortion in his animation and an anything-for-a-laugh approach that made him one of the most outrageously funny directors at Termite Terrace. Clampett was one of the first animators to work under Leon Schlesinger.
Leon Schlesinger was not a cartoonist or a writer, and thank God he knew it. And that's why he left us to try out our own ideas. Now, if we'd been at Disney's, we couldn't have done that, you see. Leon was a fellow who, in the early days, had movies, had been a barker on a movie thing where people would get on a railroad car, and the scenery would go by in motion pictures, and he would be the barker on that. So he was somewhat of a showman at heart, you see. And Leon did contribute certain things. He had a vaudeville sense. And he was the one that says, hey, let's have the music a little faster on the main title. You know, da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. You see, if it wasn't for Leon, that would have been played a little slower. On the ends, he always says, let's end with one good gag and then Iris fast, leave him laughing. And then hit him with the fast music. That was Leon. About this time, I was feeding a lot of gag ideas and story ideas to Leon, and I said, may I direct one just to show that I could do something funnier than they're doing? And he said, here's what I have in mind. He says, there's a fellow at Universal that I think could make a very good director. And he said, what I'm going to do is team you with him. I want you to collaborate with him on stories, and I'm going to give you two fellows your own little building in the middle of the lot. And I could have practically gone right up through the ceiling like a skyrocket. I was so excited. The following Monday, I met Tex Avery for the first time.
In 1935, Schlesinger hired his most innovative director, Tex Avery. Avery recently said, I attempted to do things that Walt Disney wouldn't dare to do. And indeed, Avery was the first of the Warner's directors to move that studio away from imitating the increasingly realistic Disney timing and animation.
And here's a drawing that was made that day by one of the artists in the studio. Aztecs and I left Leon's office and headed over for what became Termite Terrace. The first morning that Tex and I arrived, we sat in this funny, dilapidated little wooden building all by ourselves. We were all alone, but by noontime, we decided that we weren't actually maybe alone. We thought maybe there might be thousands of little termites throughout the wood in the building. So right then and there, we decided to call it Termite Terrace. About a year later, Tex got the idea to do a cartoon called Porky's Duck Hunt. And so we wrote this story with all these crazy ducks in it. We eventually boiled it down to one duck. And Tex gave me the first scene of Daffy to animate, in which he said, make him exit funny. And I had him do the funny jumps and spins and so forth. After we saw the pencil test on that, we thought it was so funny, but it needed some sound with it, some music or some voice. So we decided to put the woo-hoo woos on it, and that was recorded and laid in afterwards.
Oh, it's me again.
After we saw the full picture of how funny it was for Daffy to do the woos around the screen, we said, where else can we put a little bit of that in? There was no place in the picture, so we decided on the end title where it says, that's all, folks. Tex had me animate Daffy coming in around the letters, doing the woo-woos around the letters. It was this type of thing that was brand new, and it was the start of the Warner style.
The first cartoon we ever made was called Sinking in the Bathtub, and it had Tiptoe Through the Tulips in it. This was, I guess, 1930. We made the first Looney Tune.
Friz Freleng has spanned the entire development of the Warner cartoon from beginning to end. Freleng's cartoons evidence a great interest in showmanship and dance, and few directors have been more skillful in the synchronization of music to animation.
Music, maestro, please. E-flat from the top.
We seemed to go off on a thing where we kind of beat out Mickey Mouse, who was a little boy scout, you know. Disney didn't dare change Mickey Mouse. He was from the early 30s, and he was very reluctant to change him because people knew Mickey Mouse, and he stayed with the Mickey Mouse concept. But we did anything that came into our head. Cartoons that we designed were never designed in our minds for children. All our audiences were adults, really.
Uh-oh, here we go again.
Just one, give me one, just one, one, one.
We never had children in mind when we made. We made them for ourselves, really.
Chuck Jones started animating for Leon Schlesinger in 1935 and has been directing since 1938. He is probably the most famous living cartoon director and brought to the screen The Roadrunner and Coyote and Pepe Le Pew, and he refined and developed the personalities of Bugs Bunny and Daffy Duck.
Take a peek up and see if he's still around. Righto. Is he still there?
Still lurking about.
I tell you what, you go up and act as a decoy and lure him away.
No more for me, thanks. I'm driving.
At the beginning, I kind of tried to imitate the Disney style to find out what the heck it was all about. And the stuff was a lot softer. And I guess I'm not really that soft or that cute. And a tendency, you have a tendency when you work cute on cute characters to be talking down a little bit. And I found out that I better deal with characters that were examples of my own failings, certainly not my own triumphs.
Me too. Me be.
We didn't think of ourselves as being anything but having fun, enjoying making the pictures, and getting paid not much as we would have liked to have been paid, but we took it out by doing experimenting. And we had a lot of fun doing the films. We were like a mad bunch of otters, and we really enjoyed it.
When she dances, go and see her as she capers and prances, my gal. Don't do much talking, dances, even when she's walking.
One and two and three and four, she dances all day long.
Oh, my gal is a high-born stepper, ginger, with salt and pepper. She's a fancy stepper. When she dances, go and see her as she capers and prances. What's up, Jack? Also a rabbit hater. Oh, well.
Tex Avery, shown in the center here, is credited as the creator of the definitive Bugs Bunny. But his own films are based less on character and more on the recognition of animation's potential for abstraction and surrealism. Avery created a constant awareness of the audience with such devices as signs commenting on the action, or frame lines being broken through, or characters walking out and reading their credits, or members of the real audience getting up and interacting with with the characters on the screen. All of these distancing devices were invented by Tex Avery at Termite Terrace, and when he left in 1941 to go to MGM, the devices blossomed in his films there.
Behold,
Surreal comic mayhem can be created out of lust and sexual frustration, as demonstrated in Tex Avery's 1949 MGM cartoon, Little Rural Riding Hood.
Oh, Wolfie, please tell me, do what makes me love you so? You're not rugged, it's true, but when I look at you, I just, oh, Wolfie, oh, Wolfie.
This is how most animated cartoons start out, as a series of individual drawings, each one slightly different than the one that precedes it and the one that follows after. And it is on this special drawing board with a metal disc that moves around and a piece of glass and a light shining through underneath that the animator works on the sometimes thousands of drawings that may be required for even the shortest 10-minute animated cartoon. Animators have been called actors with a pencil, and this is a very good description, because not only do they create characters that can move and dance and sing, but they also create characters that can express emotions and create moods and affect audiences, make you laugh and cry, as well as any flesh and blood actor. The directors at Warner's had access to many fine animators who were capable of creating full personality cartoons. To name only a few of these animators, there was Ken Harris, Virgil Ross, Robert Bobo Cannon, Sid Sutherland, and Lou Garnier. Robert McKimson was an animator who later became a director of the cartoons. And Frank Tashlin also worked as an animator and a director at Warner's. And he developed many of the ideas that he used later in his live-action feature films. After a soundtrack has been recorded, the director can then start laying out what are known as the pose drawings. Now, these are the drawings that tell the story. For instance, in this action of Bugs Bunny sitting down, the director may have started by drawing just this first drawing of Bugs standing up, and then the second drawing of him sitting down, like this. Then he would take these drawings to the animator and explain to him why Bugs was sitting down. And then this explanation and the pose drawings plus the exposure sheet would enable the animator to go ahead and complete the action so that it fitted properly into the film. These pose drawings are very important because they establish the director's style and personality in them. For instance, Avery and Clampett preferred very strong, exaggerated poses, which perfectly depicted the distortions in the mind of their characters.
In the second Tweety cartoon, I had him say a line like, "Ooh, the poor putty tat." He fall down, go, "Boom!" See, now when I had him say "boom," I stretched him, you know, maybe two-thirds of the screen, you see, way out of context of the cute little bird, but it set the audience back in their seats, and then they roared with laughter.
Jones' poses, on the other hand, were of a more understated quality with very subtle emotional shadings.
With me, there was always a limit because I'm primarily concerned with character. I'm primarily concerned with not what Bugs Bunny is, but who he is, and to get inside of what he is and feeling from my viewpoint. So that was the reason that our characters, that Bugs Bunny, who was animated by and directed by originally and most needfully by Tex Avery, but Friz and Bob McKimson and Clampett and I always had slightly different rabbits. They were different personalities and they were worked in different ways. Not so much that they really got completely off track, but to me it's the inside of the character.
All shorts begin with an idea, and Termite Terrace had some of the best story and gagmen in the business. Perhaps the studio's top gagman was Mike Maltese, who was a storyman from 1937 until 1958, working alone or in collaboration with Ted Pierce. From 1946, he worked exclusively for Chuck Jones' unit. Maltese wrote and sketched, for all the storymen had to be able to translate their ideas into drawings, some of the funniest cartoons ever to come out of Termite Terrace, full of Max Sennett-like sight gags and clever dialogue. Here in a clip from Rabbit Seasoning is Maltese at the top of his form combining literacy with slapstick.
This is preposterous! Say, what's the matter with you anyway? Don't you even know a rabbit when you see one? It's true, Doc. I'm a rabbit, all right. Would you like to shoot me now or wait till you get home? Shoot him now! Shoot him now! You keep out of this. He doesn't have to shoot you now. He does so have to shoot me now. I demand that you shoot me now. Let's run through that again. Okay. Would you like to shoot me now or wait till you get home? Shoot him now. Shoot him now. You keep out of this. He doesn't have to shoot you now. Ha! That's it! Hold it right there! Pronoun trouble.
And in Bully for Bugs, Maltese builds the gags as intricately as Keaton did to an inevitable explosive climax. Music played an important part in the Warner's cartoons, often commenting on the stories with a contemporary tune from Warner's own music publishing firm. The man responsible for the development of the cartoons' music was Carl Stalling, a former organist and orchestra leader in Kansas City, where he also met Walt Disney. Later in Hollywood, Stalling became the Disney Studios' first musical director. In 1936, he joined the Warner's gang and composed over 600 cartoon scores in 22 years. In Showbiz Bugs, we can hear how Stalling used music as a background theme.
We're on!
And in countless cartoons, Stalling's vigorous music is used as a subtext, which perfectly mirrored the animation and often commented on it.
Now I have seen everything.
I used to make some of the sound effects verbally, such as the
boo-rip,
and I used to do it better. It was more like
boo-rip.
It still doesn't sound like it.
The man responsible for coordinating and creating the brilliant sound effects in the cartoons was Treg Brown. According to composer Stalling, Treg had thousands of sound effects on short reels, and he would make up a whole soundtrack out of these, as well as adding new ones for each cartoon.
Stand back, musketeers! They shall sample my blade!
Touché! Oh, 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 oh! Musketeers? On guard! My blade! Whoever's in charge here, the scenery. Where's the scenery?
A major contributor to the uniqueness of the characters created at the Warner Studio was the voice expert Mel Blanc. It is difficult to think of any of the cartoons without their unique voices. They were a major part of their personalities. Here, Mel Blanc and Chuck Jones recreate a recording session of 22 years ago for a Daffy Duck short, Duck Amuck. In order to add an unusual quality to Blanc's voices of Porky Pig and Daffy Duck, the recording would be speeded up slightly on a machine called the Thiatron.
Okay, have a sure way. Daffy Ducky had a farm, E-I-A-I-O.
And on this farm he had an igloo, E-I-E-I-O. Would it be too much to ask if we could make up our minds?
The director was the man who pulled all of these elements together, and he was an animator, so he knew how to make characters come alive on the screen. In fact, many of the characters often took on his personality and idiosyncrasies.
Well, where's the rest of me? It isn't as though I haven't lived up to my contract, goodness knows. And goodness knows it isn't as though I haven't kept myself trim, goodness knows. I've done that. That's strange. All of a sudden, I don't quite feel like myself. Oh, I feel all right, and yet you know better than that!
The Looney Tunes and Merry Melodies were number one over the Disneys. Because Disney kind of slipped with his shorts and went into the features, and he spent more of his time and thoughts into the features.
Thanks for the sour persimmons, cousin.
The interesting thing is that the people at the schools and universities, and indeed children, seem to treat these as though they were just done. That's the nice thing about it, you know. They're not historic. When I go someplace, I'm treated as an artifact, but my films are not. And boy, that is nice.
Ladies and gentlemen, there will be no further delays, so I shall attempt to entertain you in my own inimitable fashion.
Termite Terrace was a wonderful moment because it was an opportunity to do something completely original. It was a new hope.
Under a spreading chestnut tree, the village smithy stands. The smith mightier than man is famous, strong and sinewy. Hands!
All right, enough is enough. This is the final, the very, very last straw. Who is responsible for this? I demand that you show yourself. Who are you?
Am I a stinker?
Next week, Camera 3 will explore in further detail how the directors created and refined the characters and gags, and we'll see why some animated characters were successful and became stars, and why some did not.
How many American families buy U.S. savings bonds from the payroll savings plan?
Oh, about 9.5 million.
Actually, it's 9.5 million.
The Bronc premiere.
Syndicate hitman in my town.
Jack Pellens has only seconds.
Salelli's people went out dead.
To find this man before he strikes again.
Premiere tonight on CBS.
Fortunately, we at Warner Brothers had the freedom of doing any character under the umbrella of Looney Tunes and Merry Melodies. We came up under that umbrella with about 14 different characters. The first one was Porky Pig, Daffy Duck, Elmer Fudd, and Sylvester the Cat, working with Tweety, so that was a team. Coyote, the Roadrunner, Yosemite Sam, who worked with the popular character Bugs Bunny.
He showed me a picture of a little rabbit. He said, he's a tough little stinker, and we need a tough voice for him. So I said, why not? So I figured, which is the funniest, which is the toughest, the Brooklyn or the Bronx? So I put the two of them together.
And that's how Bugs Bunny came out, Doc.
He was a little stinker, and still is, I guess.
Mr. Jones, wait! Oh, please, wait! Oh, Mr. Jones, Frankie and Perry just aren't in it. You're my swooner, dreamboat, lover boy. May I have your autograph, please? Oh, may I? Oh, thank you, Mr. Jones.
This is John Canemaker for Camera 3. Today we are continuing our exploration into the animated cartoons of the boys from Termite Terrace, that being the nickname the cartoon directors gave to the Warner Brothers Animation Studio in Hollywood. Bugs Bunny, being sketched here by Chuck Jones, is one of the most famous cartoon characters ever to hit the screen.
And then usually the carrot. Actually, the easiest way to draw a Bugs Bunny is to draw a carrot and then hook a rabbit onto it, like so. You notice the pinky up, which is very important. It indicates a kind of an elegance about the rabbit, which is part of his character.
Bugs Bunny started off...
The longest tenure of any cartoon director at Warner Brothers was held by Friz Freleng.
As a cast as a rabbit who was defending himself against a hunter. That, I think that was the first cartoon was made, and was done by Tex Avery. I'm talking about the rabbit that finally ended up being the popular rabbit. There were Bugs Bunnies made prior to that that wasn't even the same character, really. He was a wild, insane character. And that was in the black and white days.
The character who would become Bugs Bunny made his screen debut in 1938 in Porky's Hare Hunt, but it would be 2 years and three more shorts before the sophisticated, understated Bugs Bunny personality we all know would emerge in director Tex Avery's A Wild Hare. Time passed and the years were kind to Bugs Bunny, improving and streamlining not only his appearance, but his entire personality. This transformation is due not just to the drawing of the character, but to the tremendous amount of attention the directors placed on his behavior.
Once we have the drawing, and then we put down the drawing, we start to talk to the animator, then we have to decide how do these characters differ in terms of their posture, so that you know what the postures, by the way they stand, who are they, so that you can imitate them. In other words, you can imitate Daffy with this feeling, like he's got to move. Even when he's laughing, he's in a position to move away. They say Keaton, the Buster Keaton's basic thing, of since he couldn't change his facial expression, practically everything he did was with his feet. So that when he was like this, if he's going to move away or if he's going to jump up and down. So everything was done there, but the face had to stay still, so it had to be body. So then we discovered, we're not, you know, we will steal from most any source. But Daffy, being a coward, then has bent legs like this and ready to go. Bugs Bunny, in the same situation, will rest all his weight on one leg, and the other leg's out like this, and he brings it up, and he takes a bite, and he says, what's up, Doc? Now, that's where Tex Avery really established the character, when Bugs came out and looked over Elmer's shoulder and took a bite out of the carrot and says, what's up, Doc?
Okay, Wabbit, now I've got you. What's up, Doc?
I'm hunting wabbits. It's wabbit season.
Oh, wabbit season, huh? Having any luck?
Bugs is being a counter-revolutionary. He's minding his own business. He's in a hole. Until somebody comes along and tries to take away his life or his foot or send him off in a rocket or something like this. And so he then counter-revolutions.
Chuck was more a sophisticated kind of a guy, and he started educating Bugs. He started using words that the average these and those guys don't even know, but Chuck knew. And he started injecting those into the character itself, and that we've had to pull back from that. Mine and Chuck that we had to get back to the Dees and Doe's characters.
Leopold!
Each one drifted into a different direction, pulling away from the original concept of the character. We had to remind each other that what Bugs really was. So in the exchange of our thoughts and storyboarding, we worked together on storyboards, we would remind each other to get back on the track what Bugs really was. When Chuck did it, he was kind of a short-legged little rabbit, and he became a kind of a Groucho Marx.
By always starting him out as a rabbit and then letting him engage, he's more like Groucho Marx, perhaps. Of course, you realize this means war.
Into Las Vegas, San Bernardino. Of course, you realize this means war.
All of the characters and all of the stories, the continuing stories, the series, develop disciplines. That is things that you, as Groucho Marx says, humor isn't so much what you do as what you don't do. You narrow the character down. When you think of a person like Chaplin, that little funny little costume he had, that he achieved all these miracles with that little bitty hat and that funny little outfit and so on. Curiously enough, the same Chaplin wore the same costume that Laurel and Hardy did. Laurel and Hardy wore derbies and the tight collar and the tight coats and big pants. No matter what shape they were, they all dressed that way, and yet they weren't. You'd never confuse them. It's a very good example of what is meant by body action, that you can tell the difference between Hardy and Laurel by this kind of thing or this kind of thing. You know which is which. So as you work, and as in the case of Bugs Bunny, why the Bugs Bunny thing was one of the basic disciplines was he starts out as a rabbit and then fights back. What's Opera, Doc? We took the 14 hours of the Ring of the Nibelung, Wagner's Ring of the Nibelung, which is an obstacle course in opera. And then this was all pre-recorded. It happened the Warners had an enormous orchestra there. They were doing something, I don't remember what it was, and we had a 60-piece orchestra, full symphony orchestra to do the music, and it was all pre-recorded and all worked out according to musical beats. Everything in it. There were 104 cuts, which is very unusual for a cartoon, in 6 minutes. And everything lived up to the music.
Be very quiet. I'm hunting rabbits.
Another discipline here was that it was the basic Bugs Bunny, Elmer Fudd situation, except that they were playing it as Wagner would play it, and everybody had to sing their parts.
Kill the rabbit, kill the rabbit, kill the rabbit.
Kill the rabbit?
Mel Blanc is a fine musician, and that helped enormously. And Arthur Q. Bryan, who did Elmer, had one time been a boy chorister.
Oh, mighty warrior of great fighting stock, might I inquire to ask him, what's up, Doc?
That was the rabbit.
I kind of enjoyed Bugs, though, as Brunhilde, when he got dressed up in one place in there and put a helmet on and wore these big, beautiful yellow locks and wore the helmet like Brunhilde. And had enormous eyebrows. He looked real kind of sexy and nice. He just played it right to the core, which is the way Bugs hopefully did everything. He was playing Brunhilde, by God. He was Brunhilde.
Yes, I know it. I can't help it.
Oh, Brunhilde, be my love.
When I did cartoons, I did them mostly with Yosemite Sam, who was much more of an aggressive.
Whoa, dragon!
Bugs was more on the defense.
In Friz Freleng's case, when he had the Yosemite Sam, who's an explosive character, you know, and he leaps up and says, I hate wabbits!
Quick! The singing sword's been stolen! Wake up, fire-breathing lizard! Ow. Stop breathing on me, you idiot!
Yosemite Sam, toughest guy that ever shot a gumdrop.
I know how you got to Yosemite Sam, though, and that was because you just simply got inside of Friz and studied his soul.
Yeah.
If Friz spoke the way he thought, that's what he would sound like.
Yeah.
That's why he could do Yosemite Sam, you know. He really explosive kind of a personality.
You idiot!
A major contributor to the personalities of the Warner characters, one might say the soul of the characters, was the voice expert Mel Blanc. His strong, recognizable voices created a link between the cartoons and the audience and gave a foundation of reality to the outrageous gags on the screen.
No, no, don't sneeze, you stupid dragon, or you'll blow us to the moon! Dragons is so stupid!
Adios! Have a nice trip! Bon voyage! Farewell to thee!
They always showed me the picture first and asked me to create a voice for it. Of course, they told me what the story was going to be, and then I would have to create a voice for it. I said, if a pig would talk, he'd talk with a grunt. You know, a pig says, oink, 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 oink.
That's why that Porky got a voice.
Then they showed me a picture of a big sloppy cat and a little baby bird. And so I went accordingly. I created the voice for little Tweety as a little baby.
Ooh, I thought I saw a pretty cat.
And Sylvester was sloppy, so I made him sloppy.
Suffering succotash. You bet he's slop, putty tat. That putty tat is me.
I thought I saw a putty tat.
The little French skunk, they told me he was a great lover.
So I give him the lover's voice. It is the pussycat and kiss her.
Ah, c'est l'amour. Ah, c'est toujours. Ah, c'est l'amour. Huh?
And Speedy Gonzales was a little tiny Mexican mouse.
So I made him a little mouse, talk very fast, too. Talk so fast you could hardly understand what he said, I think.
Several characters appeared over the years in Warner shorts who, for a variety of reasons, did not sustain public interest and did not become big stars. Here, for instance, is Caveman Inky and the Minor Bird. Mark Antony, the bulldog. A singing frog with plenty of personality was used in only one short, the allegorical One Froggy Evening.
The problem with One Froggy Evening was that we had to have a frog that was believable as a frog. It couldn't be just an anthropomorphic character, again, to use the rather gaudy term. That is a character who acts like a human being and walks like a human being. This had to be a real frog in order to be believable. So we had to study frogs, and if you remember as a kid, why any of you remember, if you ever picked up a frog, you know, they hang there, and their little arms hang down like this, and they're sort of sloppy and stuff like that. So we got the feeling that a frog who doesn't really divide in the middle very well, as most characters do, he doesn't have a head as separate from the rest of him. So what I did in this case was to try to figure out a character that was starting with a mouth, because he's a singing frog, and he's also rather cocky. When he sings, he's a straight frog until he starts to sing, and then for a short time he becomes this mad guy, and he wears a top hat, dances along. But you'll notice that he doesn't separate, his head doesn't separate from his body, which is true of most of the frogs, and of course all reptiles when you come to think about it. So he danced sort of like this, carrying a cane in the old-fashioned vaudeville way. This would be the cane coming through here. And then usually your fingers are tapping your hat, the old vaudevillians did. So basically this was the way the character worked when he was in action. When he wasn't in action as a dancer and singer, why he was at the beginning of the picture, he's just a plain old frog, which is a big, massy kind of a thing like this. You may notice that frogs are wall-eyed too. One eye always looks slightly away from the other, and they have this kind of a look to them. But they certainly don't look like they're going to do this, which is what he does. He goes from this action to this action, and that was the whole point about the frog. A real frog who suddenly jumps up and sings and dances.
Hello, my baby. Hello, my honey. Hello, my rag. I'm gal. Send me a kiss, my wire. Baby, my heart's on fire. Honey, you lose me, then you'll be left alone. Oh, baby, telephone and tell me I'm your own.
One of the greatest series of animated cartoons ever made are the Roadrunner and Coyote series devised by Chuck Jones.
The coyote looks sort of like Bugs Bunny to start with, and but he's got a real long nose. If you want to make somebody that looks starved, you take this, again, the same old pear shape, but it's a kind of a withered pear. And he's always looking sort of faintly disgruntled. Well, I'll put it this way. As someone said, if he's not disgruntled, he certainly isn't gruntled. The less that a person has to offer in the world, very often the more elegant the postures are. So you find a guy like the coyote, who is a pretty scrabbly guy, and probably the only animal in the world that has both kinds of tics. A facial tick and the kind that carry Rocky Mountain spotted fever. What the hell, I'm putting a carrot in his hand. That won't do, will it? Well, let's just say that he's saying hello in his own language. In the background, you put a roadrunner, who also is based on the same principle, the little head, long neck, slightly pear-shaped body, tail up like so. The real roadrunner erects this comb of his only when he's going to fight or kill a rattlesnake or something, which they do. But I kept it up all the time. And the beep beep, which is the only thing that's ever heard, is on these cartoons. So, like so, and then you bring the long legs up. They're sort of like flying fish of the land, the roadrunner is. An animal that goes at tremendous rates of speed, but really can't fly. They can only sail.
Beep beep. Beep beep.
This is the way this gives you some idea of how the character developed. The original coyote was a four-legged animal who was like this, and we tended to call him Don Coyote. Fortunately, we didn't. But we were using the Latin description of him, Carnivorus vulgaris, and the roadrunner Accelerata incredibilis. But you can see that he changed an enormous amount. This looks more like the real bird looks, but he gradually became a little different, and this was awkward to animate, and it didn't look right. And this guy gradually stood up on his hind legs, but you notice that he was emaciated then, and I don't know why the tongue was sticking out. At any rate, we got rid of that. But the characters develop over a period of time.
Meep, meep.
In the case of the Roadrunner, Mike Maltese and I always felt that they should be kept in the southwestern American desert, although there seemed like you could do marvelous things in a city or up in the Arctic or someplace like that. But not so. The characters had to remain in the southwestern American desert, and the more we narrowed it, the better it got. I mean, the more discipline you imposed, it seems the wider the humor became. We kept them, the disciplines, and in the case of the Roadrunner and Coyote, would be that the Roadrunner being a Roadrunner stays on a road, ipso facto. We imposed that. The Roadrunner can leave the road, providing he draws a white line across the desert or puts a sign which says detour or something of that kind. Basically, the seven or eight disciplines that were employed, by and by, it almost came down to the idea the only enemy that the coyote had was gravity. I mean, he was always falling off of things. The rotor never harms the coyote beyond coming up behind him and saying beep beep.
Beep beep.
Really, and then maybe he'd hit a spring and that would bounce him back and the whole thing would continue on. Also, we found out that there were 11 gags. By some curious coincidence, nobody knew why. Way in Hopalong Casualty, there was a marvelous thing, and a great animator named Ken Harris animated this, and the roadrunner, the coyote was trying to capture the roadrunner, and he had a bottle of Acme earthquake pills. Fool your friends, it says, Acme earthquake pills. And so he put a bunch of them out there and then put a sign on saying bird seed. The roadrunner came in and ate it, and the coyote thought, boy, I've got him, you know, he's full of them. And but the roadrunner went off, and then he looked at it, and he was disappointed in the thing. So he took the top off, and he put one in and swallowed it himself to see whether he was, you know, and he hit himself on the side, someone. And then being completely disgusted and damn fool too, he drank them all. Then terrible things happened. I miss the characters of Warner Brothers. Yeah, of course. When you spend so much time with them, they become very much the part of your life, and you get involved with them. Also, you've seen them develop. So each one of these characters became endearing, you know, and you got to understand them and like them. And all of a sudden, the rug came out from underneath it. Jack Warner, in some brilliant piece of his own logic, decided to close the cartoons to presumably for economic reasons. However, the Bugs Bunny show has been on networks one way or the other, not one way or the other, one way. That is primetime television, either on Saturday or on primetime in the evenings since 1956. And it just seems to me that these characters are still very much alive, and the people that did them are very much alive. Friz Freleng obviously could do Yosemite Sams and Tweety Bird and Sylvester's and stuff. And I'd love to be able to do the Roadrunner and Coyote, some more short subjects. It'd be more expensive, but it seems to me like a good investment. But the wisdom of the present Warner Brothers management seems to indicate differently.
I do believe that the cartoon of the 40s and the 50s still is dominant in their humor. I think people still enjoy, adults, children alike, still enjoy these things. Although they're put on, you very seldom see a cartoon in a theater anymore because the theaters just don't buy them because they have one big picture and they don't want to take up the time with a cartoon.
And the only times that I've been allowed to do it, to do any Roadrunner and Coyotes, was to do four or five little segments for the electric company about 2 or 3 years ago. It's kind of interesting because, in a way, the Roadrunner and Coyote were considered too violent to be used on network television, but they were not considered too violent to be used on a children's television workshop program, the electric company. So, in a way, it's kind of a justification. If you need a justification, I don't think we do.
Today, animation flourishes around the world as an industry on television and in theatrical feature films, and as a medium of personal expression by independent artist filmmakers and other communicators. The conditions of financing and distribution that made the Warner Shorts possible no longer exist, so we will probably never see their like again. The boys from Termite Terrace expanded the emotional horizons of the new art of animation, and their work represents a very joyful chapter in the history of that art. The continuing, overwhelming popularity of the films and the public's affection for the characters is the ultimate tribute that can be paid to the special genius of the boys from Termite Terrace.
What have I done? I've killed the rabbit. Poor little Bunny. Poor little rabbit.
Well, what did you expect in an opera? A happy ending?
Friends, there's a quiet emergency in the world, as quiet as starvation. It is starvation, facing 500 million children in Africa, Asia, and Latin America. UNICEF, the United Nations Children's Fund, is working to prevent this, the most awful catastrophe in history. Please help with a contribution. Send something today to UNICEF, United Nations, New York.
Mom and Dad always want me to know how great America is. So, we're always seeing historic things and beautiful places all around America. But I don't know. The way things are going, I wonder what it'll be like when us kids get big. If grown-ups keep wasting fuel, there may not be any by the time I get to college. We got a right to the same kind of America they had, don't we? So come on, everybody. Give us kids our chance.
Kojak's family connection. His nephew is a drug addict.
Johnny's out.
I think he's headed for a stash of heroin that's almost pure, and he doesn't know it.
Then Bronk takes on the killer of Mexican nationals.
Killed 14 men, and I'm not going to send them out for 6 months.
Tonight on CBS.